Excellent. All right. Well, we've already got quite a healthy number of people, so it's really great to have you all here for the inaugural event of what we're calling these Software Spotlight Series. So my name is George Booth. I'm a reader at King's College London, but I'm also co-chair of the events and training for the MMM Hub with Ed Smith at Brunel. And the MMM Hub is the Tier 2 consortium that administrates over the young supercomputer I hope you've all heard of. And part of our remit is to kind of work to facilitate some sort of national consortium to aid access and to facilitate efficient use of HPC on these facilities. So I'm also interest group chair of the methods interest group for the Thomas Young Center as well. And so we're kind of doing a kind of a cross event between these two institutions to try and just reach as many people as possible. And I said this is the inaugural event, the Software Spotlights, partly in response to kind of user surveys from the MMM Hub. And what we aim to do with these is to really do a bit of a deep dive into some of the widely used simulation packages for materials and molecular modeling. And I'm very, very pleased to introduce Alin Marin Elena from STFC at Daresbury Laboratories. And our first code that we're going to be looking at is the DL Poly code for molecular dynamics. The DL Poly code has a long history, started way back in 1993 under EPSRC as part of the CCP5 project, which is still closely linked. And it's a sort of a UK flagship code and continues to be actively developed at Daresbury Laboratory and elsewhere. And we're very lucky to have one of the main developers with us here today. So Alin did his PhD with Giovanni Cicotti in his group in Dublin, and then moved to the Irish Centre for High Performance Computing, and then in 2015 moved to STFC at Daresbury Laboratory, where part of his role over the last few years has been in this refactoring of the DL Poly code to enable it to be ported to ever larger systems and scale up to large system sizes efficiently. And part of that has been a large new update just in the last couple of months with DL Poly 4 version 5. And so we're going to be hearing about some of that in this event. So the plan for these Software Spotlight events is to start off looking a little bit at the capabilities of the code and the research that can be enabled by it. And then in the second half, we're going to be looking a little bit of a live demo, hopefully, all things going well and hopefully avoiding all technical gremlins, and look at the kind of actual anatomy of a DL Poly calculation, the input, the output, all those sorts of technical details to really hope that we can sort of lower the barrier of entry to these sorts of codes. And finally, at the end, we're gonna have a bit of a Q&A with Alin and hopefully then host it all on the website so it's available to people. So without further ado, I will hand over to Alin. I should say, by the way, if people have questions, then do put them in the chat. I'll monitor that and answer them at the Q&A. But when it comes to the live demo, also feel free to unmute yourself and just jump in as well if it's a question relevant to what's being discussed at the time. Okay, so thank you very much. Over to Alin.
Okay, thank you, George. Thank you, George, Ed, and Karen for the invitation. Oh, I forgot to share my screen, no? Sorry for that. Okay, do you see?
Looks good to me.
Okay.
Yes, full screen, perfect.
Okay, perfect. I suspect you don't see the mouse, or you see the mouse too.
Yeah, we see the mouse as well.
Perfect, just in case. Okay, so thank you, George and Karen, for the invitation. This afternoon, I will present you a very, very high overview of DL Poly. I try to stay away from equations with a little bit of sim mainly a high-level overview of what features we have, and then what doesn't work, what works, and then a simple demonstration of how to run one calculation, and I will show you even an error and how to fix it. Usually people hit it. So I will speak about DL Poly. Then I will introduce some, what I call helpers. So these are not things related directly to DL Poly, but are programs that can make your life much easier when you are playing with DL Poly. And then at the end, we'll do a little bit of a demo. Okay, so I hope the computer, my computer will not crash. So if you lose me, you may have to bear with me so I come back. So DL Poly, how George was saying, is developed mainly at the Dartsbury Laboratory, which is somewhere in the north of England, northwest. For those of you who want to put it in a more intellectual spot, is the place where the author of Alice in Wonderland was born. Okay. What is the talk not about? Okay, the talk is it's about DL Poly and not about molecular dynamics. If you want to learn molecular dynamics, I recommend you to read Mike Allen book and Dominic Kisley or Dan Frankel and Baron Smith or Mark Tuckerman. And of course, if you really want to learn and you don't want to read, you can come to the summer school. Unfortunately, it's fully booked this year, so you can apply for the next year only. Okay, just to be clear what the expectations are. What is DL Poly 4? Okay, DL Poly 4 is called for historical reasons. It's a classical molecular dynamics code. So I stress very classical because if you are into molecular simulation using force fields and what was Newton's equations of motion or similar, modern techniques tend to go beyond what DL Poly and in general any molecular dynamics code does by default. Okay, was started by Bill Smith and company under the CCP5 umbrella. Few of the people who used the code at the beginning, fortunately Bill is retired nowadays, but few of the people who used and were around CCP5 at the time as young lecturers, they are still around nowadays. I think Richard is one of them. Steve Parker is still around and is using the code from the few people. Started in 1992, and the scope of the code was to take advantage of the supercomputers of the time, which were approaching fast the teraflop point, if I remember correctly. And supposed to use this, what was at the time new technology, to program parallel computers, MPI. Initially, it was memory replicated. The current version, since 2003, it's memory distributed. Okay. If you want to do modern classical molecular dynamics, you can do that in DL Poly using Plunt 2 plugin. That it's natively integrated in here, and there are some people who use it for success. It's written in Fortran, was rewritten a few times. The current rewrite is in modern Fortran. We'll go a little bit more details later. You can download it for gitlab.com. If you go to that link, it's there. And it's under LGPL 3.0 license. Okay. People who over the time sponsored, put the money into the code, it's important to remember. As George was saying, EPSRC, who was the sponsor of the CCP5, UK COMES, and the COSEC nowadays, and MCC, STFC, then various computing initiatives that existed, like Archer via ECSC and HPCX via, which was the predecessor of the Archer, Intel, NVIDIA, NAG, at the time they sponsored, for example, Intel to look into porting the Apollo Xeon 5 NVIDIA sponsored an early port of the Arboretum GPU, which unfortunately nowadays is not available anymore. NAG, I think when Ian was working there, was involved in optimizing various bits of the code. I think in Minerals project, Martin Dove in Cambridge, and I think Ian was at the time in Cambridge too. Of course, that took the money, but without the people, nothing happens. So as I said, Bill and Tim Forrester were the original. I think Morris Leslie from the, let's say, the old guard. None of them is actually working in science anymore. Bill and Morris, I think, are retired. Tim is doing something else these days. And of course, the younger generation, you see that longer list of names there. Okay, some contributed to their contributions you find in the older versions of Diapoli, like Diapoli Classic. Some have contributions only in the modern Diapoli 4 version. Of course, if you look and read papers that use Diapoli, you will find out that there is a variety of Diapoli versions, homebrewed by different groups, which unfortunately do not have a public release. So there are at least five or six groups that I know that they have modified versions of the Arboretum that we use. And the bigger picture, what we do here at the lab in the computational science group, I just put the picture or the time scale pictures, which I think everybody who is involved in multi-scale modeling knows it. Here at STFC, in a way or another, we cover almost anything from quantum Monte Carlo, I understand these days, up to finite elements. Diapoli is somewhere in the middle and it's targeting the atomistic part. Of course, I have colleagues who work on other things like DPD, you can use the Dialmiso or kinetic Monte Carlo, AKMC, coarse-grained. And the other bit that is using directly Diapoli is the ChemShell that uses Diapoli for the classical part of the quantum mechanical molecular mechanics aspect of the calculation. Okay, so Diapoli doesn't exist in empty. There is an entire ecosystem of molecular simulation software that here we developed and files here and at RAL too, rather for laboratory. Now, where is used? Okay, so this is a question that always people ask you. So what I did, I went on Google and then I looked at what people use Diapoli for in the last year or so. Okay, so there are quite a lot of papers there. I just selected some that I like the pictures. It's not metallic organic frameworks. Since some group in Germany studies using Diapoli, I've seen other versions of the code using ionic liquids, kind of all kind of stuff. There's a group in Portugal, if I remember. Something which was very interesting, the oil brine calcite simulation, which is very nice, I like it. Is a Chinese group with connections in Leeds that they do it. Very, very nice paper if you are interested in seeing contact angles in bubbles on surfaces and things like that. And they use the Diapoli for that. This, unfortunately, I have to disclaim, I'm somehow involved in the work. It's an archive was sent for publishing it, was sent to publish, it's done in a QMOL by Aaron and Oliver in Kostya Tarchenko's group. They use Diapoli to study radiation damage in helium diffusion in zircon. So this is a picture that I lifted from the manuscript that we submitted for publication. And the last one, which is a prototype of a light-driven sodium pump. Here, the pump is used via ChemShell. It's a paper, a group from the Paul Scherrer Institute published recently in Nature. So you see then, of course, because I couldn't put more pictures here, if you have the original citation of the papers, if you're interested to read more. There are other papers published in various fields, you know, going from diffusion in zeolites and other cage structures. For example, this one, the benzene one, it's published by people in Richard Catlow's group recently. Esterification reaction via molecular dynamics. More fundamental stuff, if you see crossover, the dynamical instability and chaos in supercritical state, this is done on Leonard Jones particles. It's a pretty theoretical paper. So desalination with nanotubes, glass transitions, and this again, some calcite grouping in Netherlands, if I remember correctly, and we use the alkali to study aqua solutions of calcite. Now, all these systems, when you put them in a molecular dynamics code, you have to reduce the concepts of atoms and molecules to something that the code understands. Okay, and what Dear Poly understands is what was taught by the various developers over the years, and it understands point atoms. It understands atoms which are bonded via springs, or what is called flexible bonds. Okay, this is a very high level picture. In reality, the potential may be a little bit different than a spring. Or you can have constrained bonds via a holonomic constraint. You can have rigid molecules, and of course, you can have rigid molecules which are put together via a flexible bond, or you can have rigid molecules put together via a constraint. I think this is available only in the Poly classifier, if I remember correctly. Of course, you can simulate polarizability via polarizable ions model, via Drude model, Kosher model, or Drude model, or some people model. So, intramolecular interactions are practically represented by two sets. What people who study biophysical systems, chemical bonds, angles, dihedrals, impropers, inversions, practically all the terms which are in the original Warshall term, Warshall force field representation that was originally implemented in CHARM, I think, the main codes, plus all kinds of other things like tethers, Kosher units, holonomic constraints, PMF units, which are potential of mean force units, rigid body units. All these are defined per site. Okay, so a site is just, let's say, a prototypical representation of an atom, if you want. Then you have intermolecular interactions, which are represented by van der Waals interaction, or like metal potentials, for people who are more into solids, that you know, support the EAM, some versions of the EAM potential, Gupta, Finney-Sinclair, Sutton-Chern. Then you have free body like Tersov or other type of free bodies, four bodies. The potentials can be analytical or tabulated. Okay, and this is important because if you search in the Dear Poly manual and you do not find the analytical form that you are after, you can build your own table and you can fill it in. The intermolecular, they are defined by species, by the type of atom rather by individual atoms. Okay, so these are important distinctions. Of course, another bit if you want to do the simulation, it's electrostatics, and we do electrostatics in Dear Poly in the modern version by using SPME to smooth particle mesh to solve the long-range interaction, the Ewald summation practically. It involves as of, I'm not going to enter into the details of the algorithm, involves practically a short range evaluation of the forces and another evaluation in the reciprocal space that involves Fourier transforms. Okay, there are other forms of electrostatics approximative that you can use. There is even the Fuchs correction if your cell is not non-neutral. Okay, the ion polarization or the Drude model, like you saw there, it's implemented in two versions: via dynamic adiabatic or via relaxed shell models. Okay, you can have external fields: electric, magnetic, gravitational, oscillating continuous shear, aquatic sphere, repulsive wall. Yeah, these are things which are native in the airplane that you can do that. Okay, of course, if you use plumed, you can have other kind of external fields if you want to call them to the rare events simulations and other stuff like that. Mathematically, all this is ends up a very nice equation. And why I put this one? I put it to stress that once you build the airpoly, you have access directly to all these terms. If you are used with other simulation packages, usually if you want to use free body or four body terms, or if you want to use metal, you have to explicitly tell, or some other special potential, you explicitly have to tell. When you build the code, I would like to use these potentials. The airpoly differs from other codes in this, in the sense that all the potentials that we support are available in any ones you build by default. Okay, periodic boundary conditions. Yes, you can simulate isolated systems if you are interested, but in principle, people who use the airpoly are not really looking at that. We look at cubic periodic boundaries, orthorhombic parallelepiped boundaries. This is more common. The isolated macromolecule is very natural, if I understand correctly, in QMM. So there is used without people explicitly knowing. Okay. In the airpoly classic, if you are looking for more exotic periodic boundary conditions, you can look and you can have truncated and octahedral and rhombic dodecahedron. Okay, integrations of equations of motion. We support velocity Verlet. Older versions supported leapfrog Verlet, which was removed. We fix time step and with variable time step. Okay, variable time step doesn't mean multi-step. Okay, just for people to be sure for that. The variable time step is very useful for radiation damage or when you try to equilibrate the system and you do not really know your potential very well, can come very easy to prevent crashes. We support all the standard thermostats, NVE, NVT, NPT, in all their variation. Probably one that you will see that is missing is where the nozzle hoover chains. Is true, we don't do that, but we support almost large vein, gentle stochastic, and Norman Nozzle-Hoover and Martina Turkerman in the classic potentials. There are N sigma T, NPT, gamma, large vein, more special thermostats if you want to deal with molecules on surfaces and things like that, you may want to look into that. By default, the Airpoly supports DPD thermostats, okay? It's not a competition of the ERMISO. The ERMISO is much more complex and much more specialized in this, but if you want to do very simple DPD simulations, you can use the Airpoly for that one too. If you want to be very specialized, I suggest you use the ERMISO. There is a special type of thermostat and boundary thermostat that is used for radiation damage. It's similar in spirit to the thermostat of Chicoti and the thermostat of Lefkantorovich if you come from other fields. And the two temperature thermostats that I think Dorothy Duffy in UCL and Kostia worked on for a few years back. holonomic constraints are implemented in DL-Poly via a parallelized shake rattle algorithm. Okay, so if you study this, if you read the original paper of shake or the rattle, leapfrog or velocity variant, depending on how you apply it, you'll find out that that algorithm is inherent a sequential algorithm. What Bill did when they wrote initially DL-Poly, because they wanted to write it parallel, they went back in the original paper and they devised an algorithm to apply the constraints which has some parallelism in it. Of course, due to the iterative nature of the algorithm, the parallelism cannot be perfect, but still it's there and it exists, because sometimes people tell you that there is no such thing as a parallel shake, which is not true. Unfortunately, this is just a small technical note in the original paper of DL-Poly. At the time, I suspect Bill and the team, they didn't consider it was necessary to write a special paper about it. You can do rigid body by using nose equation as well. So other aspects related that we can impact the performance and how the DL-Poly works are two that I want to mention. First is the domain decomposition that is used for MPI parallelization. Practically, your space is split in equal parallelepipeda, if you want to say. And each of them is associated with an MPI domain, and usually they communicate, if you are lucky, just between the neighbors. Just between the immediate neighbors. Okay, there is an inherent limitation of the approach that is used in DL-Poly. You cannot have a domain smaller than the cutoff of your potential, the short range potential. Of course, that limits on how many cores you can. You can run, especially for systems which are not very big size. Neighbor lists are computed. It's a very common strategy in molecular dynamics, rather than computing the forces between all the n atoms in the system. You use a strategy to reduce from an n squared to an n log n problem. In DL-Poly, there are two strategies. Both of them are based on linked cells with subselling. Each of them has its own advantages depending on what system you are studying. To select one or another, there is a flag at compilation time. Okay, so you have to be very careful if you want to try it. You have to compile the code with the right options. All this is documented in the instructions. What can you compute? You can compute the statistics of common thermodynamics properties. Practically, DL-Poly always will dump this file, which is a little bit different compared with other codes. You can compute different probability distribution functions, like the radial distribution function, the VAF, the velocity autocorrelation, mean square displacement, density profile. You can compute other type of PDFs. Older versions could compute angles and bonds, but only topological angles and bonds. Now in the newer version, you can define any three atoms to compute an angle in between them to get a PDF on them. You can generate, of course, trajectories. You can do various defects analysis. You can replay trajectories. You can compute thermal conductivity these days. This is for the flux. Short-range corrections, they were existed there, but now Jacob added extra calculations for some of the Lennard-Jones potentials, some of the powers of Lennard-Jones potentials. So if you rely on the fact that you need this 1 over r for powers 6 and 12 and some other powers exactly computed, you can do it. Optionally, you can build your DL-Poly with empirical valence bond if you try to study some kind of reactivity. Of course, in the framework of empirical valence bond, you will be able to do NVE, NPT, which I don't think you can do in other codes, even if they have NPT for sure, not even if they have empirical valence bond. The memory is distributed by MPI, as I said, is pretty common now in all the codes. DLPOL is force field agnostic, so it doesn't know by itself of any force field. You have to explicitly specify the force field. It's an all-in-one, and I told you, it's almost, since there are some options that you can select at build time. Special radiation damage analysis tools, we added quite a few with Kostia's group. If you want other potentials that we do not have, and you do not want to build a table for them, or you cannot build a table for them, you can use the open key to have access to them. Modern modeling techniques like rare events and things like that, you can do via plumed too. You can do geometry minimization, of course, and the parallel I/O is implemented via API. Okay. Language, I said, is written in Fortran, just some numbers. It's around 100,000 lines of code nowadays. Okay. It's written in Fortran 2003 and 2008. The current version of the standard is 2018, unfortunately not very well supported by compilers. Okay, these are numbers that I had in August last summer. And these are people who contributed in the last few years to the code according to Git. What did we learn from the refactoring process? We added a new build system to Snake, continuous integration, and the necessary tests were added, which is quite a lot of work, which a lot of time is not really directly translatable into new features or papers. We have a new control format that, if I have time, I will show you, that Jacob got the task on it to modernize the input format of the control file of DLPOL. We remove some old features like leapfrog, for example, as an integration method. We deprecated and marked for removal something like netcdf, not because there is anything wrong with netcdf, just because the code is rotten, and we plan to replace it maybe with HDF5 or ADIOS. We discover new bugs, for example, in the multipose, we discovered it's a bug, so now it's disabled. We added a new timing system, and just this refactoring actually even speed up the code a little bit. Scalability. This is what everybody wants to know, how fast your code, how many cores you can use. And my question when people ask this, and depends on your problem, depends on your potential, depends on your machine. There's so many things that is very difficult to answer with one question. This is a graph that I lifted from Ian's presentation. About, so you see here we have the strong scaling for a system which has close to 2 million atoms of natrium chloride. It's a simple system, but it's important because it has two important components. It has what is called the short range, the van der Waals interaction, and the electrostatics, okay, in it. So you can see that the short range, both in DLPOL and DAMPS, they scale close to perfect for up to 3,000 cores. But you see that the long range, which is the part which involves the 3D FFT transform, it's hampering the code. Of course, similar scaling behavior you see on the link lists and things like that. Okay, so you see that at least in the test that we did, at least for the long range, we probably had slightly better scalability for the long range. There is another thing you do, you understand your code, but you have to understand that the profile of the code changes with the number of processes that you are using. And you can see while here we started with a calculation at the low nodes that was dominated by the short range calculations. Once you increase the number of course, the MDI process is what you obtain, that the calculation is dominated by the long range calculation. So it doesn't matter how much you speed up your link cells or how much you speed up other components of the code, the long range will dominate. So that's why the scalability and how fast is the code, it's a very complex question to answer. Martin guessed who collected scalability and benchmark data on the poly for more than 25 years. We put together a paper, so if you are interested, you can read more about performance of the code. Okay, if you need help, report the bugs, please, or report features on GitLab.com. We have an entry on the Material Science Forum, so you can put your stuff there. We have a matrix room. The link is on the GitLab. You can join it if you want. It's not that somebody will be there all the time, but you may be lucky. And of course, we have the Python companion that I'm writing with Jaco, we wrote. And the other one is DLField. While DLPolyPy is mainly to process your output, DLField will be there for you to process your prepare complicated inputs, especially if you use biomolecular force fields. This is what you want to look at. Okay. Building DLPoly, let's see if we can get on. Okay, it's a of course, because it died, I don't have the history. It's relatively simple business. All you need to do.
Alan, sorry, just quickly, do you think it'd be possible to just make that terminal full screen?
And yes.
Perhaps increase the font size.
Yes,
we can. A little bit. That'd be great, thanks.
Is big enough?
Yeah, I think that's good, thanks.
Okay, so to build the DLPoly, let me see. I will not put them the slides full screen. It's a relatively simple command. So DLPolyPy is the helper that I was telling. You can download it from GitLab.com. And the other, okay, which jump that, you can get it from pip if you want. DLField, here is the link where you can get and helps you. If you need to use forces like charm, amber, clay, FF, and things like that, for more complex stuff, DLField is the thing that you want to use to generate the force field for you. Installation, it's simple. Practically, this is all you need. You clone 5.0b, and you can use CMake and we build everything for you. If you need extra options, you just put them after CMake, and then it will configure. To run, if you don't use default names, we'll see later, you can just use -c and to pass a control file. Okay. DLPoly has three categories of file: input files. Minimalistic, you have a config file, by default it's called config in capitals, a force field file, by default is called field, and the control file, by default is called control. Output files, by default you get a status file, called like this default, and a log file, which is called output. You get another two files, which are, you can say they are output, but they are useful for restarting the calculation. RevCon contains the positions, velocities, and forces, and statistics, if you need to restart, is contained in Revive. Other files are for tabulated potential, the table, RDF is given to you by the RDF dat, trajectory, what is called the history file. The full listing is in the manual. Okay? So now let's see some example. Because in the scalability test we have natrium chloride, I just got example of natrium chloride. So you see the three files that we have here, practically the config file, which contains the config, the atom configuration, the atom coordinates in this case only. So it contains a title, then three numbers that indicate how much detail, zero only positions, one velocity is two means force is two, what type of boundary condition, this means it's a cubic, and how many atoms are in the file. Then the cell, the dimensions, the vectors, and then you have one line telling you what is the name of the atom, the index of the atom, which is not mandatory, you can get around, and then the coordinates, okay? And you can go and in this way, if you have velocities, you put velocity, forces, forces, and you go on and you describe all your system. Of course, you see in this case, I simulated using atomistic simulation Python, implemented there, everything. Then the other file, which is important, is the force field file, okay? In this case, natrium chloride is a relatively simple system, so we do not need too much, but we need to specify the name. We need to specify the units in which things are done. Qcal, per mole, you can have different units. You have to be careful what you choose. How many molecular types we have inside? So practically, in this case, would be only one, because we have only a natrium chloride. And then we describe each of them. Sodium chloride is the name of this type. We have 256 entities, because it describes them in pairs of two, one natrium, one chloride. Atoms says, tells you how many of them. And then for each atom, you describe a name, it can be whatever you want, a mass, a charge, if there is a charge or not, and how many times is repeated in the config file. And the zero indicates that the atom is allowed to move. If you put one, the atom will be fixed. Similar for natrium chloride. Practically, this will describe you 256 patterns, each pattern two atoms, and it containing of a natrium and a chloride. And this pattern that you describe here has to be exactly the same pattern that you match into the config file. Otherwise, we'll tell you that it cannot run. Finish, we say that we finished the description of this molecular type. Then we specify the van der Waals interaction, or the short-range interactions in this case, natrium-natrium, some Lennard-Jones potential, and the epsilon for the Lennard-Jones potential and the sigma for the Lennard-Jones potential. Similar for natrium chloride interaction and the chloride chloride. And of course, you have to finish with close. This is how you describe the force field. Of course, there's not enough. You need a control file, which will be able to drive the simulation and what it does. Okay, we have a title. What temperature we want? We want to run, firstly, an equilibration for 1,000 steps. In total, we will run 2,000 steps. The time step, it's 0.01 picoseconds. The cutoff in the short range and in the Coulombic will be 8 angstroms. Air pad, it's one angstrom. As you see, the options here, they tend to be practically a keyword and the value, and sometimes you have some kind of optional attributes, like steps in this case and things like that. EWAL precision says that we want to compute long-range functions, and ensemble, we want to use the microcanonical ensemble. We want to print every 100 step in the output, and the statistics, we want to collect it every 10 steps, and we collect all the time. And here, there are two special directives. If you are not used with new DL poly, they are new, that we specify to you the field file, and to be read from a file called natrium chloride field, and the coordinates to be read from the natrium chloride config, okay? And in this case, we want to compute every 100 steps the RTF, and we want to print it. Now, these are two keywords that usually you do not see in a normal input file for DL poly. The direct tells DL poly to evaluate the short range explicitly, rather than going through an intermediate table at the beginning. This, for modern CPUs, can result in 20-25% speedup, depending on the potential that you are using. As I told you, in addition to the status and the output and other explicit files, like RDF in this case, that you want to generate, what you will have these restart files that DL poly will write periodically for you. And so it guarantees that if something happens, like machine crashes, you can restart the calculation. And this dump parameter does exactly that. Keso says to dump every 1,000 steps rather than whatever is the default. In this case, I think it's 500. And this is very important, especially on machines like Young, where the file system can be very, can vary into performance. If you specify dump, you know, like maybe every 1 hour or every 2 hours, whatever you can afford to lose of the calculation, that can speed up your calculation quite a lot. Because I noticed on Young, when we were doing some simulations with a collaborator, that had quite an impact on calculations, things which could speed up, slow down even 20 times. There are two other special job time. After this time, TL Poly will shut down by itself before being killed by the queuing system, if you have one. And close time, how much time to hold to close the files for you. So practically, the job time will become, in this case, 10,000 minus 100. And of course, finish at the end. Okay, I'm not going to run because, okay, everything runs quite fast, you will see. I have already an output file here, and you can see it. You get a banner when it runs. You have some warnings that we hope to silence them in the new versions. A little bit about what you choose. A lot of the things are default there, so you didn't choose them, so you do not know. So it'll be the input-output parameters. So this way it says that we use 4 MPI processes because I run these calculations on 4 MPI processes. You see here it says 4 processes. And it will use 4 processes, MPI processes to write the output. Of course, if you run on many, you may want to control this number. If you run 1,000, the Poly will do its best to guess for you, but sometimes it fails, so you will have to do it. Other bits will tell you where it, okay, not file outputs, of course, should tell you inputs, where it's getting things from, system parameters, what ensemble you choose, bits related to the force field, like cutoffs, padding, density of subselling. These are parameters to control the link cell algorithm. How you compute the van der Waals, if you compute direct or tabulated, what cutoff, how you compute the electrostatics, tells you what mesh in reciprocal space is used, tells you things about the RDF, how it will be collected. By default, it's not printing you the topology, it's printing you a little bit about the box. And then it's telling you when various things are finished. Here tells you what are the corrections to the fact that you are using a cutoff in the van der Waals, degrees of freedom. And this is probably the important part when it starts the integration. So we'll print you in the output by default some energy decomposition, total energy, the temperature, configuration energy, the Coulombic energy, and then the decomposition of energy based on various terms in the potential that you can have or you do not have. Of course, the virial terms too. Okay, so this is how it goes. And then we told him to run 1,000 steps. At step 1,000 should tell you that the calibration is finished and now it starts to generate production data. Okay, so the simulation continues. Of course, because we are using a microcanonical ensemble, we know that the total energy should be conserved, so we can use this as a indicator that our simulation goes right or not. At the end, you will get a pressure tensor and fluctuations and some approximation for the 3D diffusion coefficients and the mean square. Okay, so you can use them to understand if your things go right or not before starting to do deeper analysis of your data. what this version is putting to you, starting with 4.10, we put you at the end a table of how long various parts of the code took to run. So then you can try to see if something goes wrong or not expected. We see because we use it an error pad, we don't evaluate the link cells every time, but the other things are evaluated every single steps. Of course, there is no bounded force, so the times are practically zero. Okay, but by default, all the terms are into the calculation. Okay, so this is practically the main output. Of course, this is mainly for your eyes and to have a good overview of the calculation. If you want to run something automatic, usually to do some statistics, you will read the statis file, which will contain all the statistics about your simulation. But you see, this time it's how we say in the input, every 10 steps, not every 100 steps, how was the output in the log file. Okay, there is a duplication, but we serve different purposes. Okay, if everything will be nice, which probably will not, I can start the Jupyter notebook and I can show you. Let's risk it. How you can analyze the statis. This is using the ViewPolyPy. Some simple functions. So we can use it to plot. In this case, I'm plotting the temperature of the system, but reading the statis file. Or I can read the RDF file and I can print the radial distribution function directly from the RDF using ViewPolyPy. Dear PolyPy. Of course, this is nice, but it's useful only once you have the calculation. So a lot of time, the first thing will be to do your calculation. Natrium chloride is very simple, okay? Not the simplest example that you can see, but we can move to a little bit more complex example that you might want to see. Let's add some salt in water practically. So practically what I did here, you know, like when you are a PhD student, the supervisor comes to you and says, will be nice to simulate this. And you think how to do it. And I started practically, I have the same three files. You can use Bagmol, DL field, you can use various codes to create the solvation, but in this case, practically, I started with a box of water and I just change a water molecule to two of the atoms to natrium and chloride and I removed the excess one. What you will see here is the force field, which is, of course, more complex this time. You have two molecular types, the water, in this case, 1000 molecules. Plus, which we described as before, only that this time you have to describe topology because we know the water has covalent bonds and we model them by harmonic springs. We use the bonds keyword and angles go again harmonic and we model them like this. Natrium chloride needs to be described again and is the second molecular species, the type of it we have into the calculation. Of course, now you have much more van der Waals interactions, but this depends on your model. You cannot just come and get them from thin air. An option that ViewPolyPy has nice and other codes allow you to use various mixing rules. So if you have van der Waals interaction parameters between only between oxygen, oxygen, natrium, natrium, and chloride, chloride, you can get away with writing the mixed terms by using one of the mixing rules. The input, the control file is more or less the same. There is nothing to see. The very special there is the same as before, only that because this time we did something very barbarian, you can say, we just prepare the system, which is not equilibrated. During the equilibration, your system will crash because the atoms are too close to each other and things like that. So you may want to use one of these cup force, the cup keyword with the force, to limit during the equilibration the maximum magnitude of the forces. In this way, we'll keep the atoms there and will allow you to equilibrate the system. Another thing that I had here in addition to the other one, I printed the trajectory. That means that I print a trajectory starting with step 500, practically at the end of the equilibration, and I print the frame every 10 steps and only positions. I don't need anything else. Okay, and you end up with a history file. Okay, here you can see it. In addition to the two files that we saw before the studies, the history file you can see it with VND. Okay, probably I will not remember by default. This one is not crashing. Oh, I remember. So VMD can load for you. Of course, you have to change the representation. Can load for you the trajectories produced by the airport. What we don't do in DL PolyPy, we do not read trajectories. And because we do not read on purpose, because I implemented to trajectory to be read in atomistic simulation environment, there are other codes that read these things for you. Okay, so the last minute, I will just show you the new control file that practically contains exactly the same information, only that this time the information is strictly keyword, value, and unit, nothing else. And of course, the keywords changed. Do not worry, there is an automatic script that can transform old inputs into old control files into new control files. And DL Poly is smart enough to determine which file is using loading the trajectories of DL Poly. What I wanted to show you, the new control, which, as I was saying, it's simplified in the sense that everything is unified, everything is keyword, value, and unit, if the unit makes sense. Okay, so this will simplify the input files, at least from the computer reading point of view. All this, there is nothing wrong with the previous one if you are a human, but when you are trying to read it in automatic scripts, parsing the input files, the control files, was quite problematic. Okay, so I think this is all I had to say. Sorry for all these silly technical glitches, but we made it to the end.
No worries. Thanks a lot, Alan. We'll edit it. Edit it before it goes on the website, so it will look completely seamless. But I guess, you know, we're slightly overrunning, but I think it'd be good for us to have just a couple of questions, if there are any questions from attendees about DL Poly for Alan while he's here. So opening it up to people to ask questions, either in the chat or just unmute and shout out. So just to kick us off, I guess one thing that you mentioned at the beginning and you said was removed was support for GPUs.
Okay.
I don't know what the long-term plan is for that, given the kind of trajectory of HPC architecture, if there are any prospects for that.
Okay, originally the GPU port of DL Poly was written in something which was CUDA, in between CUDA 2 and CUDA 3. So you can imagine that kind of code didn't age very well because NVIDIA was changing the GPUs and the specification quite fast. So the removal, it happened mainly because of that. Now there is a movement towards a more standardized version and approach to GPU programming. So actually we've been to the hackathon with a team from Paul Popelier group, trying to port some parts of DLPoE, which are of interest to his group on GPU. And actually we were quite successful using OpenACC. You will not get, at least we spent 2 days at the hackathon, you will not get huge performance, but it is feasible to be done. And being a standard, things will be much simpler than it used to be before. So there is a plan into that direction, okay? So even the new CCP5, we put. Of course, the shortage is not of intentions, the shortage is of people's time to work on these things. Okay.
So are there any other questions? Ed. So Ed asks how MPI calls are set and how this links to the number set in the input script. It's just in the chat function.
I don't see the chat, but it's, I mean, there is nothing in my chat, so I suspect it's only for you. So MPI, what do you mean by?
So I'm just reading from him. He says, sorry, he has to keep his mic off because his, Ed, why don't you go ahead? My daughter
stopped. She stopped screaming for a sec. So just interested in basically the link between how you specify topology on MPI and then the link to kind of specifying on the cores on Young, just for people who are interested in using this. So typically we have 40 cores on a node on Young. Just where that kind of comes into the input script and then also how you distribute your job in the kind of optimal way to get best sort of distribution.
So now depending what is your slowest part, in the past people used to say, oh, what I have to do, I have to generate powers of two, okay? Fortunately, that's not true anymore. And it's nice because the computers don't come in pairs of two CPUs anymore. So you do not have a restriction from this point of view. So you will not see any penalty if you use, for example, 40 cores instead of 40 MPI processes instead of 42, okay, from this point of view. So you will not see it. Maybe the efficiency will not be is nice, but you do not have to worry about that. What you have to worry about that if your box, the simulation box and the cutoff, they do not allow you to use all the 40 cores, then you have to underpopulate the node. Okay, so, but that's a restriction of the main decomposition algorithm. So there is no need of any special once you bind one MPI to one core, you are fine.
Okay, perfect. And that's automatically distributed. I think I missed a bit where you specified. So you will automatically distribute the code to the cores. You don't have to worry about doing
that. Yeah, you don't have to. I don't, if I remember correctly, on Young, you can do it with MPI run, but officially there is a script that does all these things behind the scenes for you. So there is no special need. So as long as the MPI processes are binded to the physical cores, there is nothing to worry about.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? I have one rather provocative question just to ask as well. I mean, I'm not asking to sort of, you know, compare code, certainly not when it comes to sort of scalability and speed. As you said, that's quite a complex and nuanced question. But many people that you are running kind of MD calculations will be using LAMPS. And I guess the question is if there's functionality in DLPoE that isn't available in LAMPS and vice versa, Is there a kind of a particular kind of niche of systems which you think DL Poly is more or better suited than LAMPS?
So now it depends. I mean, it's each code has their own people using. Okay, so in terms of speed, I can answer that question because I did the simulations into that. There are certain ways in which people cut shortcuts in order to speed up the calculations, and these are different. For example, we use for electrostatic SPME in LAMPS, we use P3M. Okay, so this is different. Each of them has its own advantages and disadvantages as a method. Okay, but that's important because, for example, each code comes with defaults on that. Okay, and if the defaults are there for speed, you compromise the accuracy of the results. And this is what happens in LAMPS for certain systems. So you have to be very, very careful when you compare in terms of speeds. Once you are happy that you get the same results, the differences in speed are nowhere to what some people claim. I know what people claim, okay? And so there is another functionality, that's a different story, okay? So indeed, there are force fields that in LAMPS exist and don't exist in DL Poly. There are options. But then if you want to do radiation damage, there are things that in DL Poly exist and they don't exist in LAMPS. If you want to do empirical valence bond, the implementation that is in DL Poly, it's only in DL Poly. It's not, as far as I know, where it's not implemented anywhere else. And of course, over the years, people implemented their own things, which exist in DL Poly. But at the end of the day, any calculation, it doesn't matter what code you are using, it's important to be sure you get the same results. And that can be a challenge. While people who do DFT, they created the famous DFT delta codes, where we compare the results in molecular dynamics, classical molecular dynamics, that doesn't exist. And that sometimes is an issue. Because whatever defaults you are using can produce different results. Okay.
Sure. All right, excellent. Thanks a lot. So Oliver Dick has a question. This should be a simple one. Do you have a manual for the Python tools?
Okay, because I skipped that slide. The manual is very minimalistic. In other words, doesn't really exist. there are some examples, self-documented. Okay. No, I'm joking. No, there is an API manual that you can extract automatic. There are some examples. If you go in the examples folder on the Python, I suspect I will give you the slides and you will put them somewhere so people can see. You will find the examples. Yes, I will have to write the manual too. At one moment or another, especially because other people want to use it now. So I'm working a project where writing the manual will be part of it. Yes, there is a question. The Python tool is specific for analyzing results. Yes, this is where is the most useful in the simple way. In reality, you can run the code with the Python code. So if you want to build a quenching or a cooling of something, run the code, run DL Poly for 1 million steps at the temperature, then change the temperature or change something, you can use it for that kind of stuff too. Okay, so it's more than that, but I didn't enter into details. I mean, was built with helping to build the workflows in mind. Okay, the DL Poly pipe. This is where it came from.
Great. Okay. Well, thanks very much. If there aren't any other questions, we've already overrun a fair amount. So thanks for sticking around with us, and we will sort of edit the video and put it up online. But thank you once again, Alan, for an excellent talk and the overview of DL Poly.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.